So now you can be careful about what you say. It's be all on tape. We'll begin our service this morning with Barbara's prelude, Gentle Like Jesus. Let us continue with our call to worship. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Now I would invite the musicians forward to share in our first hymn, Morning Has Broken.
Mine is the morning, born of the rejoice every morning, God's recreation of the new day.
Amen. God's recreation of the new day. Let us turn now to a time of prayer as we say together our congregational prayer. O Lord, you have made us in your image. You have given us power in our language, power to both create and destroy. Help us, O Lord, to bridle our tongues, to control that which has the power to destroy others. For in our fallen nature, we often yield to the temptation to vilify others rather than encourage them, to judge with our lips and our words, creating class and other distinctions that are not suitable for the people of God. For we are all one family, Lord, children of the God who created us. Help us to be ever mindful of the need to control that instrument in our mouths that can be a force of destruction. Give us pause when our thoughts enter our heads that are contrary to your will for the world and for your people. Help us to learn to control our language and direct our words to building up rather than to tearing down one another. O Lord, help us to be ever mindful of your spirit within us for that strength. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Now I would ask if there are any additions that we need to make to our prayer list this week, or any joyful answers to prayer. Okay. Yeah, that's a long ride. I think it was almost 500 miles from where she started to where she ended. Now she's back home with the dogs, and happy to be there.
So gracious that Jeffrey's
with us today. Amen for that. Absolutely. Jeff has returned. Yes, Laurie? That is certainly a concern for that population, for the residents of the Whitman House, Wickham House. There has been a cleansing of the management and the housekeeping staff as well, I guess. All right, certainly a concern. Are there others? Well, then let us continue on in prayer. As I thought of one of our neighbors who is now in the hospital, Diane Stroh, I'm not sure what the issue is, but I was told that she is now in hospice care. So we lift up Diane as well. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your presence among us. We thank you for the healing that you've done in Jeff's body, the successful surgery that he's had, and the good recovery that is taking place there. And Lord, we thank you also for Cheryl and her ride to Virginia, that she was able to accomplish it in the given time and power through all of those times when she didn't think she was going to make it. But praise God, you were with her and you strengthened her. And now she's done and back home. So we thank you for that. And Lord, we lift up prayers for the Wickham House, for the changes that are taking place there due to a takeover from another company. We ask, Lord, that you would provide for all the residents there a good place to stay, a good care for them. And Lord, if it be your will, a transfer to a place that will make that happen if it can't do it there. Lord, we thank you for all of those that are on this list, for those that are grieving the loss of loved ones, for those that are battling disease and battling health issues. We thank you for those that are anticipating surgeries and ask that you would be with all of these as you continue to care for us. For Lord, we know that you do care for us, and we see that in the provision that you make for these on our list. And we pray for your continuing nod in our own lives, that we could feel your arms wrapped around us, that we could be fierce in our determination to stay the path with you. Give us grace and your the assurance of your love and your presence. In Jesus' name we pray all these, especially we pray as Jesus taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now I would invite Brian back up here to share our offertory music. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. And I would invite you during this time of music to bring your envelopes up and place them in the plate if you haven't done so already. So without further ado.
In the midst of his children, the Lord said he would be. It doesn't take very many. It can be just two or three. And I feel that same sweet spirit that I felt oft times before. Surely I can say I've been with the Lord. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can feel the brush of angel wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. There's a holy hush around us as God's glory fills the place. I've touched the hem of his garment. I can almost see his face. And my heart is overflowing with the fullness of his joy. I know without a doubt that I've been with the Lord. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can feel the brush of angel wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Surely presence of the Lord is in this place.
Amen. What words of assurance. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the gifts that you've given us to bring back to you. We ask that you, as we share them here, that you would direct them to the place where they are most effective for the ministry. We praise you and thank you, and always, as we give back to you, make us aware of the origin of these gifts. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now I would ask Janet to come forward, my wife, by the way, to share the gospel with us. It's from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 8, verses 27 through 38.
Good morning. Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea and Philippi, and on the way he asked his disciples, "Who do you people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist, and others, Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say I am?" And Peter answered, "You are the Messiah." And he sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life?" This is the word of the Lord.
I would say that Peter must have been pretty comfortable with Jesus to take him aside to rebuke him. Can you imagine rebuking the Lord? But Peter, well, imagine. But I guess he got his comeuppance as well, being rebuked in return. So now I would invite musicians again for Be Thou My Vision as we continue with our service this morning.
My vision, O Lord of my heart, not be all else to me save that thou art. Thou my best thought by day or night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. Great God of heaven, my victory won, may I reach heaven's joys, O bright heaven's sun. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all.
Now our service continues with our Old Testament reading this morning. And we continue to look at the book of Proverbs today. This first chapter of Proverbs introduces the book as the writings of King Solomon, son of King David. They are presented as sayings to youth to learn to live a godly life and not to fall into the trap of selfish gain at the expense of others. Verse 16 of chapter 1 here sums it up this way. My child, if sinners entice you, do not consent. And in this chapter, after the introduction as being the words of Solomon, wisdom here is personified as a woman preaching to simple youth. Now let's hear Mother Wisdom. Proverbs 1, verses 20 through 33. Wisdom cries out in the street. In the squares, she raises her voice. At the busiest corner, she cries out. At the entrance of the city gate, she speaks. How long, O simple ones, will you love being simple? How long will scoffers delight in their scoffing and fools hate knowledge? Give heed to my reproof. I will pour out my thoughts to you. I will make my words known to you. because I have called and you refused, have reached out my hand and no one heeded, and because you have ignored all my counsel and would have none of my reproof, I also will laugh at your calamity. I will mock when panic strikes you, when panic strikes you like a storm, and your calamity comes like a whirlwind, when distress and anguish come upon you. Then they will call upon me, but I will not answer. They will seek me diligently, but will not find me, because they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord, would have none of my counsel and despised all my reproof. Therefore, they shall eat the fruit of their way and be sated with their own devices. For waywardness kills the simple, and the complacency of fools destroys them. But those who listen to me will be secure and will live at ease without dread of disaster. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Somewhat of a hard word, it seems. The title of my sermon today is Those Who Listen. How confident are you that you are on the path that God has chosen for you? Do you know in your heart that God has given you a sure footing in the world? Were you paying attention when your mother said, "Listen to me"? These Proverbs of Solomon begin with the foundation of wisdom, speaking as a loving and wise mother to the son who needs to know how to relate to the world and the family, to behave in the world in ways that will bring honor to his family and success to himself. This scripture tells us that mother wisdom cries out in the street. In the squares, she raises her voice. At the busiest corner, she cries out. And at the entrance to the city gates, she speaks. She's not shy about her declarations and the need to listen and obey, as my mother always said, for your own good. Can you not see your mother wagging her finger at you when you have strayed a little bit from what is proper and good? I certainly can, for there were many times in my own life when I caused my own mother such consternation by my actions. Now, I don't know why the Lord seemed to lead me to the time way back when. I was only in about fifth grade, and I acted on my fears rather than confidence in my abilities. You see, I had been through a bout of mononucleosis, that thing that is often called the kissing disease. Though at that age, I can't imagine that could have been the cause of my infection. Anyway, it had me out of school for over a month, and I was about to return to my class. But I had missed all that time, and my classmates had advanced that much further than I in their lessons, and I feared returning, being so far behind. So what did I do? I ran away from home in the middle of the night, before my scheduled return. Now, I have no idea how I thought that starting over in a strange place with strange people could be better than catching up in class with people I knew and teachers that were sympathetic to my situation. But I left home in the middle of the night, acting more on my fears than my certainties. I just couldn't see how I could catch up with all of the things I had missed while I was home. Well, needless to say, I didn't get far before the local constabulary found me and returned me home, waking up my totally unaware parents to deliver me back to where I belonged. And after the sleepy embrace and thankful reception at home, I did receive some advice about not running away from my fears, but facing them. And I did just that when I went back to school the next morning, probably a bit bleary-eyed. And I'm not sure even today that I embrace every challenge put before me, but I began to do that even at that tender young age. I did listen to my parents, at least some of the time, and they were also faithful to bring me to church every week, so I would learn of God and what God required in life. And I suppose I learned a little bit of that fear of the Lord in the back of that police car, too. It was a good authority that rescued me from my impulsiveness. It is a good thing to listen to God, to gain wisdom for life. But I think this passage from Proverbs also gives us some warnings about refusing to listen to that good advice when it says, "Because I have called and you refused, have reached out my hand and no one heeded. And because you ignored all my counsel and would have none of my reproof, I will laugh at your calamity. I will mock when panic strikes you, when panic strikes you like a storm and your calamity comes like a whirlwind, when distress and anguish come upon you." I just find it hard to imagine that wisdom or God would be so uncaring. But do you ever feel that your prayers only go as far as the ceiling over your head? Have you been so unwise in your actions, thinking that you know what is best based on your own experience and knowledge? Have you shut God out of your considerations? Or do you feel that God has shut you out? Is this passage a picture of God and God's treatment of the unwise? Does God delight in your suffering because you refuse to listen to God? Does God hang you out to dry because you have not listened? Let's just think about that for a moment. Dr. Charles Stanley often says, "You reap what you sow, more than you sow, and greater than you sow." It is an agricultural metaphor based on scripture that indicates that our actions have consequences, both good and bad. We can sow good with funds dedicated to ministries that are serving the world to abolish hunger or recover from disaster or any number of things that make the world we live in a better place. In our United Methodist tradition, UMCOR is one of the places where we sow into disaster recovery through mission shares, a rebuilding of lives torn apart by natural disasters. Every dollar we designate for UMCOR missions goes to just that, to the people who need it. All administrative costs for UMCOR are covered by the general church. The mission shares also supports international missionaries and universities to train future pastors and worship resources to help us all to praise God in our local churches. And on a more personal level, funds are sown into our families to provide for our children's future and our daily needs. All worthy causes as we follow a wise journey through this life. But we can also ignore good things and sow to our own pleasures and desires that don't have God's stamp of approval. We can sow to evil pursuits, supporting warlords and pimps, extremist politicians and greedy merchants, and suffer the consequences of putting a distance between ourselves and God. If we are not wise in our sowings, the blessings will not materialize that flow from wise choices. The choices we make have internal responses as well as external results. We have a good feeling about what we do if we follow God's direction in the doing, and a bad feeling or one of cool distance if we don't. It's not that God is taking pleasure in our calamity or delighting in our panic, but God is training us in righteousness through our sense of distance from Him. It may feel to us like God has abandoned us, but that is just not the case. God cannot bless those who will not put Him first, because of their refusal to recognize the source of the blessings. But those things that seem like they are bad can teach us how to be better. Paul tells the Romans in one of my favorite verses in Scripture, "All things work together for good for those who love God and are called according to His purpose." That sense of distance from God can create in us a desire to turn from those things that are not able to be blessed by God to things that can be blessed. That personal sense of abandonment by God can drive us to seek God more. "Because they hated knowledge," says Solomon, "and did not choose the fear of the Lord, would have none of my counsel, and despised all my reproof. Therefore they shall eat the fruit of their way, and be sated with their own devices." We need sometimes to eat the fruit of our way and see that it does not satisfy our deepest desires for fellowship with God, does not lead to fear of the Lord. Before we can turn around and find our way back to God, we can choose to go our own way, not giving any acknowledgement to God, not giving any assent to God's superior position to us, and God's wisdom that far exceeds our own. We can choose to deny the counsel of God. We can despise all my reproof in the words of Mother Wisdom here. Deciding to leave God out of our considerations and decisions does lead to a certain and decidedly inferior reward. We might even term the reward something else, such as punishment or a lack of fulfillment or some such complete and inadequate result of that choice to leave God out of our decisions and explorations. But when we decide to include God, to choose the fear of the Lord, as it says here, the result is different, resembling more reward than punishment. For waywardness kills the simple, and the complacency of fools destroys them. But those who listen to me will be secure and will live at ease without dread of disaster. Those who listen to the precepts of God will have a sense of security, a feeling of ease in the presence of a God who cares. Theirs will not be that fear that looks over their shoulder for the other shoe to drop. You know, that shoe that will crush you like a bug. It is wise to obey God and follow God's way of moral and upright thinking and behavior. For we have a saying in the church that God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. So whether we listen and experience God's peace from the start, or refuse to listen and experience God's chastisement that leads us to him through our disobedience and his patience, God's will is being done. But it's much better to listen and obey, to face our fears rather than run from them, to submit to the supreme authority of God for our own peace. Amen? Amen. And we'll go back to our music today as we praise God with the hymn, How Great Thou Art. We welcome Jeff back to the front for some music. Praise God.
Sings my soul, my Savior God to soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Amen. You have to touch my heart so deeply. The music of that song just reaches to heaven. Amen. Let us continue in our service as we near the end of it, with our congregational prayer for renewal, as we say together, O Lord, our God, open our eyes to the certainty of your hedge of protection. Keep us knowing for certain that you surround us with your love and grace. Keep our minds ever on the fact that your desire for us is to do good and not to harm. Keep our minds ever away from the wickedness in this world that would tempt us. Strengthen us with your Spirit to keep us from turning to evil. Increase in us the desire for your goodness and care for us. And make us your instruments in this world of your care for others. In the name of Jesus, our Christ, we pray. Amen. And now may the God of glory, who reigns in heaven over all, and Jesus, his Son, who reigns with him there, and the Holy Spirit that he sent to live in our hearts, be with you now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Thank you all.